Thank you very much. I will speak in English because I'm of insufficient Latinity to make you enjoy my talk in Latin, but also because one of my points actually is that there are serious problems in the propagation of living Latinity in education. Indeed, I am an opponent myself of lecturing in English. I do that quite a lot for students who are in their second, third, or even master educational phase. And my experience is that students often are not able to understand even English in a proper way. That may be because I use a lot of terms in my use of the English language that are from Latin extraction. But in general, I think we are facing a problem in education that is enormous, and that has to do with a complete change of paradigm in what children learn with respect to language and with respect to literature. In increasing fashion, I oppose teaching in English. I think that we need to learn our young people one language at a time, and in my case that would be Dutch. But of course I do wish this enterprise very well, and I'm very much a fan of living Latinity, and I think that we should try by discussing and by thinking hard how to pursue that agenda. But that is my first, perhaps even my most important point. It is not without problems. I sincerely hope that the activities of the Ateneum Illustre and the enormous and great and wonderful energy of Camillo and all of you will help indeed making possible a rebirth of, I would hesitate, a rebirth of humanism. I think humanism is a difficult term in itself, and it's quite dead and impossible to resuscitate. That would seem it to me. Too much has happened. Humanism is a Christian movement in the first place, and most of us do not longer belong to Christianity. That would be a great problem. We'll discuss that later on. A certain form of intellectual attitude, a life of literature, a life of art, that has a lot to do with the classical languages, with Latin, with Greek, of course also with other languages and disciplines. Latin indeed is the main bearer of such a life, and we should teach it to both pupils at high school and should teach it at university. And teaching it, we should use the language. I quite agree with that, and use it much more than we are doing now. Another thing that I would want to address, and I'm not following the text I have here, I'm simply speaking my heart. Another thing I want to address is the tendency in the publicity around this these three wonderful days that have been organized by Camillo. I want to counter is the tendency to describe the practice of education in the classical languages in the, at the gymnasium at this very moment as a failed enterprise. I would I personally find that quite a bit hurtful, actually. I've been teaching Latin and Greek for 18 years. Of course, I've been teaching it in Dutch. And I have been experiencing quite the things that have been said here, namely that the capacities of pupils to properly understand the classical languages have increased indeed. So these problems are there. But I also want us to stress that we have been having quite a lot of fun, actually. We have been having quite a lot of fun with Latin and Greek. And we have been reading these languages, and we've been teaching pupils what the virtues and the intricacies and also the horrors, by the way, of the literature in these languages are. And my own experience at the very school that Bas van Bommel was educated in was that 90% of the pupils actually quite enjoyed the classical languages and the lessons in these languages, and that they were very much inspired by education in this form as we have it now, to pursue indeed perhaps a life that has a more intellectual bent and is more directed towards history and the arts and the intellectual tradition than they would have without these lessons. So I think it would be wrong to say that classical education as practiced now is a complete waste of time. That is, of course, what Camillo started with by countering this suggestion. But I would counter Camillo in my turn and say there is a lot still to be said for what is being done now. And of course, it should be done much better, and we all agree to that. My last points, briefly, I was asked to speak about the 19th century, but I'm not doing that at all. But I will address the things that happened in the early 19th century briefly now. To ask the question whether what happened there is reversible, whether it is reversible, whether it is possible to return to whatever name we will give, because we agree on the content. I agree on the content of what you mean, but I would not use the term humanism. Is it possible to do that? Well. What has happened to Latin? Luigi Mirali will speak on that later on. Very briefly put, perhaps, a number of essential elements in the makeup of what we might call the Romantic paradigm, Romantic art theory, paradigm is perhaps the right word, are severely problematic to Latin culture. The concept that has been important, it is now perhaps decreasingly so, but is still important. We are still living and experiencing a Romantic paradigm in our culture, strangely enough. People would not always be aware of that, but that is, it's impossible now extensively to argue that, but I think that is the case. One of the prime aspects of the Romantic paradigm is originality, And one of the major items that has been important, at least throughout the 20th century, is the element of sincerity, both originality and sincerity as things you should find in culture and in especially in art, of course, in artistic products, were seen as opposed to the Latin tradition, which was not original but contained or consisted of extended imitation, and which was not sincere because it was not the original language of the ones that used it. Another third element, so important, which is also now decreasing, is nationalism. Nationalism was a force that was opposed to the Latin tradition, very, very much the Latin tradition, which is by its very essence international. And of course, also lastly, the political developments, development of democracy, the development of the criticism towards strict hierarchies since the French Revolution. Those were very important, very, very important factors in early 19th century culture that countered the reign of Latin. And I had actually prepared a talk on Le Rouge et Le Noir, this absolute masterpiece of Stendhal, which is in fact a commentary on Latin culture, because it and it opposes it in all possible ways. And Le Rouge et Le Noir is the story of Julien Sorel, who is a prodigy of Latin, who that is his absolute force. And this force is the black, is the dark force in the novel, and it is opposed to life in the red of the title. This novel from the 1830s is an absolutely canonical romantic work, and it shows very, very clearly that the tone of the cultural discourse was extremely hostile towards Latin. Well, afterwards came Greek, of course. Greek took over, in a certain sense, the leading role of Latin, because it could be construed, or it was construed, rightly or wrongly, as having, in a sense, this originality and this sincerity that the Latin tradition was supposed to have lacked. Other important elements in the in the loss of terrain of Latin culture. Well, perhaps for time's sake, I will now pass and say these things have led, and I'm of course much too brief and simplistic in a way, but let's try and pull it together and say these things, among others, have led to a decline of Latin and Latinity, a climate which was hostile towards Latinity, of course. Very important were the fascist, the totalitarian uses of especially the Roman Empire, which led to a widespread skepsis and skepticism towards the Roman Empire in the Anglo-Saxon world. It's evident from all films from the from even the Second World War and certainly the decennia that followed the Second World War, that the Americans saw the Roman Empire as the evil empire. So that was also a factor. Now, is this reversible? I might try and round up returning to my first point, I hope so, but I am skeptical, and I am skeptical because the problems with which I started, the problems of the capability of understanding literary language, cultivated language, abstract language, of enjoying and understanding and a deeper understanding of literary texts and history, indeed. These things are declining very, very, very rapidly. And that, I think, is the prime target that we have. The prime thing we should do is try to reverse that. And the reverse, this attempt to reverse these tendencies, I think, and perhaps then I may use the term humanism again, that the attempt to reverse this is very much connected to be able to speak the language of your listeners, to be able to connect to them. Actually, the whole motto of Petrarch was that scholasticism didn't speak the language of the listeners, and the scholastic tradition was outdated and was not in any way, it was not possible to use that for your own life. And Petrarch said, well, you've got to use these texts for your life. You've got to do something with them. Well, we should connect with young people, and we may discuss the best ways to do so. I sincerely hope that we can use Latin in that. I think it absolutely of paramount importance that Latin and Greek also remains a central pillar of the educational system. My pleading would be that the first thing we need to do is to keep young people reading and enjoying culture in a civilized way. Thank you very much.